Good afternoon, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Club at La Mama. I'm Nikki Parizo. I'm the programming director here at the Club. And on behalf of all of us at La Mama, we welcome you as we continue to celebrate La Mama's 53rd season, La Mama Earth. And for these past 2 weeks, I have been deliriously happy, at least in the environs of this room, not in my life. Okay, so, well then, no, this says how important rooms like this are, so how important the theater is, how important music is, how important artists are, and one of them will be regaling you this evening. His name is Dane Terry. He's here with Bird in the House, and it has been an incredible 2 weeks. The show just grows and grows and grows, and it is Dane Terry, Tova Shoshana, and Rose Emily Quinn, with John Hubbell on drums, Sam Weber on bass, and lights by Sarah Ray Murphy. Let's hear it for all of them. Two for having this show, and one is the release of this beautiful CD and vinyl album called Color Movie. And Mr. Terry will be back in the back of the house after the show to sell you some copy of the piece. So, and the other reason is this show, Bird in the House, which contains songs from this album. And anyway, I'm very sad, but I'm very happy that we get to hear this show again this afternoon. And it will have another life, I assure you. I'm not assured of many things, but I'm assured of that. And so as I've been saying, if Randy Newman and Ricky Lee Jones had a love child, or say Jeff Buckley and maybe Laura Nero had a love child in around 1984 or 85, this would be him. So please welcome Dane Terry, Bird in the House.
Good evening, Helen. This is Tom Bowers from the news. The most trusted voice of Channel 10. At least that's what they used to say. Who knows if they ever will again. Smile all the time. Bet you guys thought I got like a grant, didn't you? Surely he got a grant. Shows cost money. I know a lot of you know. And I do. It's true. It's very true. So I would like to take this moment at the top of our show to acknowledge the not insignificant but largely ineffective amount of money given to us by the lovely people over at Sensodyne. They wanted to be said in the back. Very sensitive people. Somewhere out there in the dark. That's my mother, Helen. It's a warm summer night. This is my childhood living room. She's a little tuckered out. And the soft glow of the in and out TV. Staticky, not staticky. We're all a little tuckered out, though, because this evening was the night swim. The annual night swim, where the pool stays open for an extra 2 hours. The whole town goes. She's had day drinking, followed by night drinking. But me, I'm in my room. Looking up at the ceiling, which is mostly just raw boards at this point, because early in the evening, the ceiling had fell down on me. All the paint fell off of it. All over my room, all over my bed. I hadn't even really wiped it off. I just was laying in it, tears drying on my face. I had had quite a night, too. My swim trunks drying over the chair. Now, normally I would be listening to the TV. You know, my mom watching Dallas or Unsolved Mysteries or Knots Landing. You guys remember Dallas? But not tonight. Tonight I was listening for a prearranged signal, watching the window, sniffling. My hands probably a little fists. But I did hear the TV's white completely out. All of a sudden, no more sound, just static. And my eyes widened and I stopped breathing for just a minute, because any boy who's ever read anything about UFOs knows exactly what that means. There's no summer storm around. And I knew that my father was probably sitting in some sports bar somewhere with the game just whited out. Had the same wide eyes. And I knew that Joey, somewhere in the dark, just across the court, was probably putting on pants. Getting ready to go.
Cuckoo!
The signal.
Static on the radio, static on the TV.
flowers floating off the ground. I heard voices suddenly distant.
Honey, can you hear me? Honey? Honey? Don't slap him in the face. What kind of nurse are you?
And I blink my little eyes open in the hospital. Why do they always make hospitals so bright? I couldn't see anything. Except my mother's face slowly came into focus. And all the little beeps were around. Beep, beep. And I couldn't really talk because my mouth was dry like it is when you wake up in a hospital. So my mom said, "Now, honey, don't worry." And she takes her squirt bottle and she squirts my teeth. And I'm like, "Oh, honey, we were so worried about you. What were you even doing out in them woods? Oh, I just fell asleep. I just must have passed out right in front of the TV. Oh, baby. Oh, don't ever do that again. Now, listen, I hope you know." And she dabbed my head with a wet cloth. "I hope you know that what happened the other day wasn't your fault. It wasn't your fault at all. We got so worried that you'd run away. And if you'd ever done anything like that, me and your father..." And
ask him about the fire.
A voice from behind my mother. My mother kind of stepped aside, and this larger figure came into focus. "Hi, Dane." My mother said, "Honey, this doctor wants to ask you a few questions." "That's right, Dane. You would think I was a doctor wearing this white coat, and it's true, I am a doctor, in fact, Dane." "Very true, Mrs. Terry. But also, underneath the white coat, I'm wearing a black suit. Isn't that right, Dane? And that suggests some things." "But sometimes things are two things, Dane." "That's life." My eyes looked down to his belt, and he said, "Oh, you're an astute boy. I'm a doctor with a gun." "That's right. Not all doctors have guns, but doctors that work for the government have guns. Now listen, I want to talk to you about the fire." "Yes, that's right, the Hankelman's factory fire. You probably don't know anything about it since you were sleeping in the woods all night, I know. Passed out naked. But the Hankelman's factory burned down to the ground. Yeah. And I know you don't have anything to do with it, Dane. I wouldn't even be here. Except for we down at the Doctors with a Gun Club. We were just talking with a gun. We just thought it was a little coincidental that you were found passed out naked next to a burning factory that your mother had just been terminated from 2 days ago. You see what I mean, Dane? It's a little bit of a coincidence. So like I said, I'm sure we'll get it all straightened out. But since we really don't have any control over what we remember, I've taken the liberty to hook you up to my little machine here while you were sleeping. It helps sort things out." And I looked over at the machine and it was glowing. This weird green. I'd never seen anything like it before. And I looked down and I did indeed have wires coming out of my body. And he reached over and he flipped a switch and the machine started to whir. He said, "Now, Dane, this will go real quick. I'm just going to ask you a few questions, and the machine will help you answer them. You're not afraid, are you, Dane?" I looked at the machine, and I said, "No."
Beep.
"Oh, good, it's working. So, Dane, this is just like the dentist. You remember the dentist, don't you? All I'm going to do is ask you to count backwards from 10, all right?" And he flipped another switch on the machine, and I started to feel pretty good. And I heard his voice starting to drift away. "Start counting, Dane." And I heard my own voice come out of my mouth like a Teddy Ruxpin whose batteries were dying.
"Very good, Dane. Keep talking, Dane. Start at the beginning, Dane."
"Alan, get out of the car. Just look at these eagles. Just look at these eagles, Helen. one. Hi, kids. Get out of the car. Just look at these egos. That's your country's bird.
So I don't know why the machine took me back to my first road trip. Kind of overshot, if you ask me. There I was, 5 years old, in the backseat of my parents' car. And my dad driving. My mom doing that thing where she's just stoically smoking out the passenger seat, through a passenger side window, you know, with her hair blowing everywhere. It was kind of like... you know, just completely unaware. And my dad's showing me everything about the... This is my first time out of Ohio, so he wants to show me every, you know, the color, the changing color of the soil. You know, it's red, and well, some states it's orange. Look at that, Dane, look, that's a silo. And then the eagles, of course, you know, Dane is, and so, you know, he stops the car, and we get out of the car, and he's like, okay, now brace yourself, this is your first eagle. And so I'm like, okay. And I mean, I'm just saying, how much majesty can one fucking 5-year old take? Because it was just a speck in the sky. That should have let me know how the whole trip was going to go. Well, and maybe even more how the next 20 years was going to go, if I'm honest. And I am most of the time. I do remember getting to Disney World, though. And I hopped out of the car, a little rat tail bounced. And I ran up to the gate. My parents said, wait. I said, what? They had the money, though, so eventually I did have to wait. And the first day was great, you know? We rode the teacups, but I didn't see Mickey Mouse. And that's what I was there for. I wanted to see Mickey Mouse. I mean, he's, you know, kind of the poster child for Disney World. I figured he'd be right at the front. No, not right at the front. Second day, it's a small world, but no Mickey. I started to get worried. I mean, I thought that I would run into him, and he would have a t-shirt with a picture of me on it, and I would have a t-shirt with a picture of him on it, and there would be this moment, we'd run towards each other and embrace and understand something about our lives that we hadn't previously. Fourth day, no Mickey. I was starting to have thoughts. Mom, he wouldn't be in Frontierland. He's a mouse. It's dangerous in Frontierland. Maybe we should get out in the open. Finally, the last day we were there, the morning. I'm in the souvenir stand right in Tomorrowland, eyeing this giant lollipop. It seemed to answer a question I hadn't quite asked yet. What happened? A sort of boom that grew in my bones first. I didn't really hear it, I felt it come up from the ground and through the display cases. A bunch of flat, glossy kittens shook just a little bit. And I stepped out of the souvenir stand and I found the sky hot in my eyes. A smoke plume forming to the east over the water. Two little arms, little smoke arms, reaching up and holding the empty Florida sky. And somebody nearby dropped their Slurpee and said, Challenger. I had no idea what that meant at that point. I was 5 years old. And I looked around, and all the rides were still turning. But instead of eyes, I saw thousands of pairs of that tiny plume gazing eastward at itself. Except for one. Staring right at me from across the pavement. I froze. He was the only one not looking east. I was like... And then he started coming towards me, weaving his way in and out. All the people that were absolutely oblivious to him, and I wanted to be like, this is Mickey Mouse. And he got really close to me. Two larger versions of that plume bouncing in those big, black, lacquered eyes. And I'll remember this till the day I die. He got really close. He bent down until the plumes slid off his eyes and were replaced by two versions of a lollipop I was still holding. And then, in a voice that was not his voice, and through a smile that didn't move, he said,
"Hey, you gonna pay for that?"
Sky light pushed up.
by contrast, night in the hospital is a little boring. Just a couple of isolated beeps. I woke up. The doctor with a gun was nowhere to be seen. Everything was dark. I had vague memories of telling him everything. Of course, the machine started way back, but once they recalibrated, I heard his voice like, "We're recalibrating, Dane." And they figured it out and kind of zoomed me back up to the week of. I was still a little groggy. The night nurses, there were two of them. They weren't paying any attention to me. They were just watching the TV. Since it was back on, it had been in and out for a week now, but clear as a bell all of a sudden. So they had some catching up to do on date night programming. So I got out of bed, snuck out of bed, pulled all my wires. I was still attached to the machine, kind of back from me as I left the bed. And I approached the window, and I pulled the curtains open. And even the little bit of light from the nighttime city was kind of hurting my eyes at that point. And I looked over my town, and I guess I was just never up that high, but I never really realized how many churches there were in my city. And I looked around, and all of them had little neon crosses atop every little steeple. It was like a bunch of little lowercase t's, like an unsolved puzzle from Wheel of Fortune. You know? I'd like to solve, Pat. Titty twister. Temporary tattoo. Totalitarian toaster. There were weird categories on Wheel of Fortune. That could be one. And I don't know if it was the fact that I was looking at all the churches, but I just started to become aware that behind me, there was very hymnal kind of music coming from the TV. The night nurses must have been watching some sort of gospel program, and I heard a voice. That's right. Sometimes we have questions in our lives, and we've got to look for the answers. There's lots of places the answers can be, friends. They can be in this book right here, the Lord Jesus Christ has answered a few questions himself. But sometimes, friends, you got to go running for the answer. You got to go looking. You got to open that window and jump right out into the night air. And I almost wanted to be like, yeah, Lord. Yeah. Ain't that right, boy? The room got a little brighter. And I didn't want to look. But I had to. I looked up at the reflection of the room in the window behind me. And I saw his face on the TV. And he was looking right at me, taking up the whole screen. That's right, boy. You know what you gotta do. And then the room started flashing, and all the beats started beating. The nurses started moving. Friend, all you need is a door. Well, you gotta get up. When you want down, put your finger on the map and pick your town. If you boy, where you can stay. If I was you, I'd run away. I'd run away. I'd run away. I'd run away. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
down your barn. They come a-knocking at your door. They always knock so hard. But you gotta get up.
Knock it off.
When you're down.
Knock it off.
Put your finger on the glow and spin it round. Can't stop. You gotta go. You can run from your problem. What you're running from. Everything goes just as quick as it comes. We gotta get up.
Knock it off.
When you walk down.
Knock it off.
Put your finger on the map. Take a town. If you want it, better get to stay. Father's you. Father's you. Chair, which was the softest thing in the whole office, turned around, walked out, and closed the door behind her. And this sort of unfolding, unfurling, magical mass of blonde hair moved to reveal this giggling pink face.
She must be Dane, Helen's boy. I've heard so much about you. It's nice to finally meet you. You're bigger than all her little pictures she's got on her station. I'm Tammy. I do around here what everybody else doesn't do. Yeah.
I was watching my mother. She had closed the door, and I could see her figure through the sort of half-frosted glass window that are so common in factories. And she'd been stopped by another large figure that was very animated. She was looking very still at the large figure.
Hey.
Do you know the word flounce? I looked at Tammy and I said, no, I didn't. She said, well, it's sort of like if Fluster and Bounce had a baby. You know? And that knucklehead does an awful lot of flouncing. All right, so just ignore him, all right? Okay, honey? A boy your age must like nature. You like nature? And I sort of nodded, a nod that I learned in my childhood, the sort of vague, circular nod. They would serve me again well through my 20s. Well, I was just reading here in the Natural Geographic about the North American wolf. That's right. They're reclaiming their territories. They say they're coming down from Canada. That's right. And those suckers, they're big. I don't want to run into them. I'd say,
you know, leave them in Canada as far, but they're coming far south as Kentucky. Do you believe that? I think that's scary. They can stay in Kentucky for all I'm concerned. Just keep them out of Tennessee. It's where I'm from. It's where all my kin is from. And if my mom were to come across one of them suckers on the three-season room, oh my God. I mean, she'd shoot it, but she'd scream to high heaven for it. Anyway, let them stay in Kentucky. They can have that whole dang state. Ain't nothing but an orgy of dirty water and crooked eyes. Personally, that's what I... She wasn't really keeping my attention. I was watching my mother, who was now looking down, and more animated figure was doing this. It's like a large cheerleader of some sort. You must be excited for the night swim tomorrow. Huh? I look back towards Tammy. Everybody's gone. Have you been a good boy? You can only go if you're a good boy. And I knew that everybody went to the night swim, no matter how good you were. What are they going to do? Like, if you were bad, they were going to stay at home and drink alone instead of going and drinking with all their friends at the night swim for 2 hours while they didn't have any. You just, yeah, no, everybody went. But if you've been a good boy, and I mean a really good boy, I'll take you to the sample room. Do you want to go to the sample room? My mom was now doing that characteristic bouncing of somebody who was sobbing. So I said, yeah, let's go to the sample room. So she took me through this back hallway. She held out her hand. It had way too many knuckles on it, I think. Because I could, you know, I grabbed onto it, and it was just like a rope somebody had tied, many knots. And she led me down this hallway. Henkelman's 1909 poster, Henkelman's 1915, Henkelman's all the way through the ages, all the way down to Henkelman's 1990. It was by the sample room, and she got out her big keys, and she opened up the room. And I don't know why the sample room was so magical to me. Maybe it was the red light in a cage in the ceiling. Maybe it was the fact that everything was in little tiny bottles. Like everything. And it's the same ketchup and mustard I'd grown up with my whole life. You know, my mother worked at a condiments factory, so it's not like it was special, but under that red light and those little bottles, she started opening up the cabinets and handing the little bottles. Now this is our bread and butter ketchup. That's our number one selling product across this region. We hold a lot of the market. Now this is your classic yellow mustard right here. This is your hamburger. That's your hot dog. Relish. Dijon mustard, that's your more gourmet fare for a brat. Are you even old enough to eat brats? She gave me a visor, a Henkelman's t-shirt. She was filling up my arms. Then she stopped and she went, oh, you're gonna love this. And she handed me a cassette tape. And it said, employee orientation tape. And she said, now, you have a cassette player at home? And I did. And the only tape I have is Ray Stevens, so I was happy to get something else. And just then, both of her eyes sort of fell to the end of the room. On a display shelf that was barely lit, and she kind of gasped. Well, now I don't know. We haven't even given samples of that to the workers. But if you're real good, and you don't tell anybody, I'll let you try MERP. Now, MERP was the first blue condiment. MERP was going to put Henkelman's on the goddamn map. If only. What does a blue condiment taste like? I had no idea. So she opens up the cabinet and takes down this little bottle of, like, neon teal purple mixture and opens up a lid. And she looks at me and she says, now, fingers are dirty. So I'm just going to dab a little bit of this on the back of my knuckle and you just lick it off from there, all right? It's one of the many things that adults, what? We believe it though, don't we? Yeah, we do. And so just as my tongue almost got to the lip, Lunchtime, she says. Now, in case any of you have never worked at a factory, there's often a lunchtime song. A sort of like camaraderie moment where people kind of pat each other on the back and take off their hard hats and wipe their brows. Take 5 minutes out of their lunch break to sing a song together. And I was lucky enough to be led by the blue slimy hand of Tammy to the railing of the Henkelman's Fine Condiments Jellies and Jams factory that day, ladies and gentlemen. And I witnessed the very last lunchtime song.
We are honest and true, friendly children and animals, who we'll kill to eat if it comes down to that. We like our radio, our cars, our colors. It's under my bed, next to a few.
better believe that the first thing I did when I got home was put in that cassette tape. Dropped all the ketchup and mustard. Through the Ray Stevens tape, the worn out Ray Stevens tape, away. Hello, and welcome to the Hengelmans family. This is orientation tape number 3. New employees listening to this tape will have already completed the previous 2 orientation tapes. Orientation tape number 1, factory safety protocol and procedures. Orientation tape number 2, the downside of unions. This is orientation tape number 3, workplace morale. Hinkleman's is a family company, and has been ever since 1909, when Evermeyer Hinkleman decided to share his fine condiments, jellies, and jams with the public. And if you were going to be a part of our family here at Hinkleman's, we'd like to be a part of yours. So this exercise is called a visioning. I want you to close your eyes. I want you to imagine you're doing something fun with your friends or your family. What exactly are you doing? Where exactly are you? Who exactly is with you? I want you to imagine every detail. What are you wearing? And then I want you to take a moment and find in this fantasy a place for a Hinkleman's product. You have 30 seconds. All right. So I close my eyes. I'm way older. I'm driving in a red convertible with all my friends in college. And we're in California. Everybody goes to college. And we're driving down that one road that people always drive down in movies. It's really curvy, and our hair is blowing in the wind. We're all smiling at each other. My friend Bryler is there, and Josh, and Brian, and the other Josh, and Tice, and I don't even know how we're all fitting in this convertible, but we're all there. It's so much fun, because we're 18, we have nothing to lose, and we're sharing an ice cream cone. Yeah, and I think of it. And I look right at Bryler, and he looks right at me with a twinkle, and he takes the ice cream cone from me, and he licks it right in the same spot that I did. It makes a bigger divot. And then he hands it to me. Remember to include a Hinkleman's product. All right, we're all sharing a hot dog. And Bryler takes a bite of the hot dog and hands it to Josh. Josh takes a bite of the hot dog. Kind of a big bite, like two big old, like, who's trying to chew? And he hands it to Brian, and he hands it to Tice. By the time it gets back around to me, there's like barely any hot dog left, but I take it anyway. It's mostly bun. I get a little bit of ketchup on my cheek, and I wipe it off. Thank God it didn't get on my yellow pastel sweater. We shouldn't even be eating hot dogs in a convertible. It's dangerous, but we don't care. Even the driver, Josh, is looking at us with that look, that knows that this is going to be the best year of our lives. And then one of the Joshes, I think, reaches down and clicks on the radio, and the most perfect song is played.
Make up.
She was crying all the way home. I didn't understand what was happening. I was just reading the ingredients on the ketchup, trying to figure out what citric acid was. But she sent me up to bed. So I got into bed, and I laid there, listened to her downstairs, trying to get the TV to come in. And I was thinking about that little daydream about California still. What would I have to do to get to California? How do people get to California? How do you get there in your life? And I just had this odd feeling that for me and Bryler and Josh, and we would have to like plan it out in secret. Now, I was 12 years old, so it's not like I needed bedtime stories, and it's not like my dad came in and told me bedtime stories or anything, but occasionally he would come in and talk to me, and depending on how boozy the night had been, the stories would vary. But there was one about his childhood that stuck with me in times when I really thought, hey, I might need to get out. It's funny how parents teach you things when they don't really mean to teach you things, you know? My dad used to run moonshine for his father in Kentucky. He told this story to me before I go to bed many nights.
I knew a man with a mule that's
Sandwich with hot sauce on it. Because it's like my lunch most days. I was a weird kid. My father wasn't around. He'd been all night. They put up the football high school stadium, the high school stadium football lights. A high school football stadium lights. They move them from the high school and put them over the pool, and it takes all night. It doesn't actually take all night. We don't. And every guy in the fucking town volunteers. So my father had spent all night doing the hard work of putting up these football stadium lights. And they get done around 5 in the afternoon. They come home drunk and they change into better clothes and we all go to the night swim. So about 8 o'clock, my memory picks up and we arrive. Now, do you guys have night swims where you're from, where the pool stays open? Can people make the sound? No. Well, let me explain it. So the local pool normally closes at 9 o'clock. All right, which is sad. It's just starting to get dark out at the other end of this time zone that we're in. At that point in the summer, it stays light until about 9. And they blow a whistle at 8:45. It's that, you know, every 45 minutes there's a rest period, and they blow the whistle and everybody gets out of the pool. And normally at 8:45 they blow the whistle and that's go the fuck home. No getting back in the pool. But on a night swim, you have 2 more hours in the complete darkness of night to swim until 11 o'clock. And what's more is that instead of using a whistle to bring you back into the pool, like after a normal rest period, they use the stadium lights. They bring them and they light them up to say that the rest period's over and that the night swim has started. It's a little touch of theater that I always appreciated as a boy. And so for those 2 hours, because those stadium lights are so bright, it just becomes this kind of blue diamond world where you can do anything you want. It's completely surrounded by darkness. There's a thin margin of drunk adults and then darkness. So it really is 2 of the most magical hours of my childhood. You can play any game you want. You can become any character you want for 2 hours. So 8:45 rolls around and we all run out of the swimming pool and our moms are trying to get us to eat anything, drink a little bit of water. Shoving things in our face, and all of it has ketchup on it since they all work at the factory. So we're covered in ketchup, and all those kids run back to the edge of the water. It's not even, it's like 8:49, and we just wait, and we're heaving, and we're covered in ketchup, and we look like a band of Vikings. And of course, the time takes forever. 8:55, 8:56. The time between 8:58 and 8:59 is long enough for all of us to fill this room with our hair. 8:59, and we're looking up at the lights just to make sure that we get as soon as possible into the water. This frothiness of kids just
everybody runs in. And I start to step into the water. And I stop. Because I see a boy I've never seen before. And he sees me. He's got hazel eyes like mine. Soft hair. A sturdy jaw. He's a little older than me. And he's got the most perfect throat I've ever seen in my life. Like, the tendons were just perfect. The Adam's apple was just perfect. And he opened his mouth to say hi. He didn't really even have to talk, though, because I knew as soon as I looked at him. You know. I know. Another space villain when I see one.
Thank you.
swimming trunks. I didn't know where I was. I was lost in the woods. Joey, or Volton, or whatever, had convinced me to put eyeliner around my eyes to make us look more evil. He'd gone off his other way. And I didn't know, they still had the stadium lights on, so I didn't quite know where I was. The whole sky was lit up, that kind of like muddy orange color. And I was running through the woods and I was clearly lost. I stopped in a clearing to try to get my bearing. Is it that way? If I could just hear a sound. Just crickets. I hear it again. I took a deep breath and tried to let out a manly hello. And then into the clearing, under that muddy orange light, just visible enough, came a ball. Started swelling in my eyes, and then into the clearing came a face. And I let out a little shriek, and he went, whoa, 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 kid. Calm down. I'm not gonna hurt ya. I know I look a little weird, but I've been wandering around in the burrs all night, all over my fur. Take a deep breath. You know, we dogs can smell fear. It's not a pleasant smell, okay? So, in out. In out. Better? Oh, why are you out here in the woods anyway? What are you doing out here all alone? Naked. So I told him everything. I just broke down. I just... I mean, it was a talking dog. What did I have to lose at this point? He goes, whoa, whoa, whoa. Okay. Sounds like you don't want to go home. Swell. Stay out here. Don't go home. You don't have to go home. You can do whatever you want. Come dig up stuff with me. Get covered in burrs. Or go home. What do I care one way or the other? You don't want to go home because you think you're weird. Everybody thinks they're so weird. All you people. But every single one of you is about as special as death on a farm. You know what I mean, kid? Now, if you think that I'm just gonna waltz into this story as some kooky character and give you a bit of advice, some sort of miracle moment for you, well, that's not gonna happen, kiddo. I'm not that kind of dog. So just go on your way. Okay, one tip. You're going the wrong way. Factories that way, towns that way. Anybody with a nose knows that. Just follow the old fence down through Colder Creek, past Devil's Mound, you'll hit it eventually. Okay? Alright, good chat. Okay, two tips. But that's it. Instead of being afraid all the time, why not try being angry? It smells better. See you, kiddo. here. Me and Joey had made plans to meet up later. I was home so late. I mean, they turned the stadium lights out by this point. By the time I got back to the actual streets, the paved roads, the lights were starting to go off in the houses, and I knew that all my family would be over. They always come over after the night swim to drink well into the evening. And it really could be any kind of situation I could walk into. It really depends on the mood. I was hoping they'd all be just laughing and telling jokes, throwing the little sweet pickles at each other. And I could sneak up to my room, unnoticed. But that wasn't the situation I walked into. My aunts were futzing with the TV, which had gone out again. Probably on the game or something. And the uncles must have gotten into a tiff or a fight because they were kind of swaying, looking down at the ground. So when I walked in, they all looked at me as if something wild had gotten into their home. And there was a little semicircle that formed around my dad of his brothers as he stood up, kind of staggered, and looked at me. My eyeliner, black straps down my face. Now, this was not my dad. This was not the man who said once, as I was painting my first oil pastel in front of him, "Dane, don't be afraid to spend all your color on the sky." This was not my dad. This was a boy surrounded by his brothers. This was a mean person. So when he started to talk, a little smile spread on his face, and the ants parted. "What's on your face?" "Lights up on Dad." Thank you.
Just the hiss of the static and the clink of a beer bottle every once in a while. And I was in my room, in my bed, having all of the feelings at once. Every single feeling humanly possible being created in the factory of my heart and nuts as a 12-year-old. It's being coursed through my body, my little fists, completely white. And then a little piece of paint from my ceiling. I flipped it off. Another little piece of paint from my ceiling. I flipped it off. And then a rumble in the whole ceiling sort of peeled off in one piece. This and hit me in my bed. I jumped up. I was terrified. Ah! I screamed. And in one motion, I went out of my room and I ran downstairs, dripping paint chips all the way down. And I ran across the living room and I punched my father right in the face. Now, some moments in your life don't have music or colors, or they're just a fact, just a snapshot. The big ones, when people die, your first sexual encounter, is often just one little thing. The only thing I have of that moment is a snapshot. My dad's face sort of rubber banding back, and the look in his eye. It was confusion, it was anger, it was sadness. My father at that point was in his early 30s. He had shoulder-length wavy hair and a short cropped beard. He was covered in tattoos, and he always wore white t-shirts. So what you're seeing now is my only memory before the fight.
I only held my own.
had to come by. Put me on the porch. Now I'm a man in tie, a man in 5 o'clock. Comes around in the dark sometimes, and I see you underneath the swinging light. Dad, teach me how.
Said they had no idea what I was talking about. Gospel program? What? They put me back in bed. They said that I was still messed up from the drugs, from the doctor with the guns machine. I still don't know what that machine was. I would have loved to have one for college. They found out who started the fire. Anyway, but there was an electrical failure out in the woods. They found a hole dug kind of 4 feet down or so, kind of ferociously dug. And then they found a dog's body kind of charred. Smiling forever. And the doctor with a gun came to get his machine. He said, "Hey, kiddo," after they put me back in bed. He said, "Well, you won't be seeing much more of me now, will you?" Wrapped up some of the wires, and as he was grabbing the last little bit of the machine, I saw his Yale Drama Club ring. A little challenger. My whole childhood, actually. A lot of our childhoods are just like little explosions we don't really know the significance of. So he walked out. They took me home. They said, "You know, well, he's had like a shock. So watch him for a couple days. I just ate ice cream for a while. It was fine." My mom stayed home with me for a week since she had lost her job, but they didn't have any record of her losing her job because it burnt down. So she got a job at the Sensodyne factory. That's what $400 gets you, ladies and gentlemen. And I didn't see Joey for the rest of the summer until school started. In every class, I was like, "Oh, is he going to be in this class? Is he going to be in this class?" And it's finally until after lunch when my stomach was in my throat. And it was history class. And I was late. Probably because I had to wait till all the other boys left the bathroom before I could pee. Because they had those troughs, you know. And, you know, well, you're kids. You don't have sexualities. Pee in this giant ditch. Anyway, so I'm late. I walk into history class, and they've already started the overhead projector. So I have to do that awful thing where you walk in front of the projector light to get to your seat. So there I am, held in that kind of cold light, and I see him sitting right up front. And I look at him. And he doesn't look at me. Instead, he looks at the young men from World War I whose images are kind of painted on my body. I go to my seat. Now, the lecture was about the Christmas Truce of 1914 in World War I, which, in case you don't know, is basically what I got from it was the war had just started, and on Christmas Eve, they decided to take a break from fighting. They actually sang Christmas songs across the trenches to each other, enemies did. They had no idea at that point that there was a long war ahead. They had no idea what it would bring. They were just getting drunk on Christmas Eve, thinking, oh, this will be over soon. That's all I really took away from it anyway. Towards the end of class, there was an announcement that came over the loudspeakers were
Will the 8th grade boys participating in the spirit choir ceremony please report to the football field at the high school for a test? Thank you.
And a couple of boys in our class got up. Joey was one of them. Bryler. Josh. I watched them leave. And the lecture ended. The overhead projector went off. And one by one, the students got up and left. But I lingered. Kind of took my time putting my trapper keeper back in my backpack. My manly trapper keeper. And the picture of a horse on it. Where you could see every muscle in the horse. Just to show you I wasn't interested in muscles. I looked out the window and I saw little figures, the same boys that had gotten up in class earlier, joining other boys that had gotten up in other classes. Other Tices, other Brians, other Kevins. They were all in ill-fitting blue blazers running across the football field to the middle. And they got into formation. And somebody blew a pitch pipe. And the stadium lights came on. I recognized the most perfect Adam's apple I'd ever seen, singing our alma mater. Love to fight.
close their eyes. Be back in the fields, back in the bright skies. But a skirted gown cannot give rise like the band when they play. Game.